Hello, how are you?
I'm with the popular.
Couldn't get you right.
Okay, you're in time for some days?
Oh, good.
So get together.
So, do we start? Are we ready to start? I have not been quite informed about the responsibilities of the chairman beyond performing a ceremonial role of sitting in the chair, but at least I am happy to be back at BIDS. We've had a long innings together at BIDS. And I'm happy to catch up with the latest work which is going on. Sitting over here, we see that our two distinguished guests are not in a position to be with us. So we will attempt to fill their large shoes. And of course, I'm happy that Salim Rashid is here, who will quite capable of filling many more shoes than just two. And so it's a great privilege to in fact have him over here, and my colleagues, Sultan, Hafeez, then Zahid, and from the private sector. We look forward to in fact having brief comments from them. Now, what are the ground rules? How much time are we supposed to give the speakers? Murshid, where are you?
Ground rules.
No rules. 15 minutes, sir.
Huh?
15 minutes.
15 minutes each. That's right. Does the maths add up to that? It is supposed to be
this is Dr. Matthews.
Well, I would suggest 10 to 15 minutes, preferably 10, and then some conversations can flow from that. My own opening introduction to this would be that the bridging the research policy divide is, of course, a very ancient issue. I can only speak about this from my own experience, and I don't intend to speak about it, but merely to put some issues before the people who will be making presentations so that they can take this into account. And there are two aspects of this that I hope they will cover in their presentations, because each of them has experience from both ends of the spectrum. First, of course, is, and you had an opportunity to look at the research outputs coming out of premier organization such as BIDS. To conclude from this, that what are the policy implications which originate from the work they are actually doing? And in this respect, of course, there are two issues which I hope that the commentators will in fact bring up. One is, of course, how you in fact identify your research topics, and how far the topics then lend themselves to making policy recommendations which will be of relevance again to policymakers. And I would remind you here of the history of BIDS when it went back to its founding days is the Pakistan Institute of Development Economics, where I suppose one of the founding fathers, professor from Cambridge University, Professor Austin Robinson, felt that at that time Pakistan suffered from a severe deficiency of competent trained economists, and that consequently there was very weak research capacity, and this was impacting then on the weak quality of policy making which was going on in the then Pakistan. And so the idea of founding an organization such as this, which in those days was very handsomely funded by the Ford Foundation in unimaginable ways in terms of commitment of resources, and which bought in for over a period of almost 13 or 14 years, top-level researchers from leading universities to initiate research and then to contribute to training a whole generation of economists, of whom fortunately a significant number were from Bangladesh. And when Professor Nurul Islam took over as the director of the Institute of Development Economics, he then took this process to a logical level, particularly in focusing on research issues which were of policy relevance to Bangladesh and bringing a generation of researchers to be trained not just in research but academically in the best universities in the world. But the relevant message which you have to keep in mind is that this was an organization which was created to do research with a policy focus. Unlike institutions, particularly institutions affiliated with universities, which in fact have the privilege of broadly addressing a range of issues from policies to theory, this exclusively concentrated on policy-related issues. And this, if I recollect, had its advantages, but also some disadvantages, because there was a certain depreciation in understanding the conceptual framework of the discipline which was to underlie your research work. So when you become too obsessed with purely policy-oriented research, then you get focused a great deal more on the trees rather than looking at the broader landscape of the forest. And herein, I think, was a problem which we needed to address. Now, the relevant issue which I would want to ask the commentators today, looking at their exposure to the research output of BIDS and their understanding of research as it is going on in Bangladesh today, is how far we are getting research which in fact is going to be of service to policymakers. And this, of course, as I said, determines on how research topics are selected, whether they are in fact market determined, or whether in fact the research institute or institution has a capacity to suo moto identify priorities which relate to the concerns of the country. And here again, there is a broader question that when I am doing policy-oriented research, but what is my point of orientation? Is it only the government, or is there broader responsibility for identifying the policy concerns of the people at large, the Janagan, who have policy needs of an even stronger nature than any government? And so you have a dual responsibility of responding to your recognition and prioritization of those concerns. The third and final question I would like the discussants to focus on is, of course, the response to policy-making research. And this, in a way, reflects the seriousness of policymakers. And from long experience at BIDS, I found that the response of policymakers to research tended always to be weak. So that, in a way, research became a supply-side project where you were putting research before policymakers and beyond them to their political masters, but they were not really responding to this. So that the shelves of every minister tended to be loaded with valuable policy reports. And of course, when they were invited to the launching of a particularly important research study, the photo ops which were provided for the occasion were there, and you had a moment of coverage in the next day. But at the end, that was the end of the whole process. It was very, very rare that you will do a piece of research and then the relevant policymaker for whom, in a way, it was targeted would have given serious attention to it and would then come back to you and say, yes, I need to discuss some of the implications of this research and what are the ways in which I can then take up the policy suggestions which have been derived from this. So there is therefore a problem of demand failure, and of course partly this originates also in supply problems, because you in a way have to also calibrate your research to issues of concern to policymakers. But what you presume is of genuine concern to policymakers is not necessarily going to get a response. I have been for many years, in fact, the debt crisis which we are facing today, I would like to think, was discovered and pioneered at BIDS when we took up studies on the crisis of debt default in the financial institutions, which was a research project initiated by me with no donor funding at all. And the only resource we had at our disposal was our capacity to pay Sayyid Akhtar Mahmood, AKM Ehsan, and later Binayok Sen, salaries of 400 takas a month to in fact work 12 hours a day sitting with dirty files in financial institutions to unearth data to in fact produce their research output. The sad part of it was that crises and problems which were identified in our research about the consequences of debt default, the whole problem of loan rescheduling, and the consequences for letting this happen have perpetuated now over almost 40 years to the point where what at that time was, you may say, a dangerous fever has now become a cancer of which I'm not quite sure that there is any effective response, and you are seeing the outcome of this. So the relevant point is there a working, living market at the relevant level for the research which you are doing? So I leave these questions to those around me. Sultan Hafeez, of course, has been at my side as a researcher, and then presumably in his capacity as an international customer of research. And of course, the same would apply to Zahid. So let's take this forward. I don't know who is in fact listed to speak first. Is there a list? There must be a list. Well, let me. Yeah, well, it's Shamsul Alam. Well, let me begin by bringing in Adeem Rashid, who again has a very long exposure to doing high quality research, but doing it as an academician with a deep grounding in theoretical capabilities, which in fact has informed his research, but which has not prejudiced the passions which in fact have sort of driven his career and his research. Salim, 10 minutes?
Thank you, sir, for your kind introduction.
I'm not sure if I can be heard. Is my voice carrying through to the audience? No? Can I be heard now? Okay. I'll try and keep it closer to me. Thank you. I was a little embarrassed at sir having said that I have done high quality research. I don't know about that. I do know that I got my opportunity to study the rickshaw industry of Dhaka through his kind assistance, which was followed by a study of the thalagadis of Dhaka, which was followed by a study of Jinjira and its adulterated market. So I have a long association which sir will have forgotten, and the multitude of researchers whom he has encouraged over the years. I'm very happy to get this occasion to say a few words, and I will keep my eye on the watch very carefully. I should tell you that you are hearing my thoughts with about 10 minutes of preparation, because I came here to listen to the panel, and now I have been co-opted onto the panel. So this is, you will excuse any abruptness or abrasiveness in my language. Let me begin by saying that we look for the policy research symbiosis in the hope that there will be useful research that will be forthcoming. And as the economics profession now stands, I have my serious doubts whether we could prove the economics profession to be actually useful. In my own view, the most important economic event of the last 50 years has been the economic rise of East Asia. And if you look at the list of Nobel Prize winners, there is not a single Nobel Prize winner from East Asia. So this would suggest that the economics profession has gone one way and economic usefulness has gone another. This is not for want of many official organizations who try and foster what is called useful research. But if I may speak about the international donor organizations, they have a structural incapability on these questions. And if I can illustrate that briefly, I will say that typically you will have somebody studying Swaziland. A Bangladeshi is sent to Swaziland. He will report to a superior from Paraguay, who in turn will report to a boss in Washington, D.C. from Lithuania. Now, this is how the international bureaucracy gathers merit. But how can people from these three different countries talk and understand the economic problems of a fourth country? They can only do so by creating a language which belongs to no country. And this is in fact what is happening in the world, which is why I think so much of this research that comes out simply flies above the reality on the ground. So one has to be so careful in wanting to accept excessive donor funding, because one is talking to people who are not structurally, regardless of all their good intentions, they are not structurally capable of making contact with the ground. As a result of which, they tend to go on to highly demanding but utterly artificial scientific constraints. The most recent of which is what is called a randomized controlled trial. As though one has to wait for these randomized controlled trials to know what the real problem is. So, I would suggest that as far as the overall framework within which we approach these questions, we should be always satisfied with orders of magnitude, because that is all that one can get in a relevant policy context. So what do we say now about the policy research divide over here? In terms of research, the first fault that I would suggest, and I am not sufficiently current with the current state of funding over here to know, but insofar as the research is directed by the donors, the World Bank and such international organizations, we can't really expect much of it to be relevant. If research is to be done for Bangladesh, there has to be independent funding. People have to independently find these thoughts valuable and fund them so that research can be generated which has a permanence and a comprehensiveness that is based on felt Bangladeshi problems. To complement this, we need to be less demanding in the universities as far as teaching is concerned. I find that the standard teaching load is about 4 courses. This is speaking of the private universities. To my mind, this is absolutely absurd. You can't expect anyone to do any research, or at least any competent research, while teaching 4 courses. So, we are turning the universities into degree factories. Why should we expect any good research out there? We have to meet that challenge. There is more one can say, but I have 3 minutes left, so I will just go quickly to the other point I want to make, is that on the policy side, in order to generate research, policymakers have to feel the need for research. I think it is very hard to make a politician feel a need that is not generated by the constituents of the politician. So here perhaps a long run view should be taken. Those who are engaged in policy research should always think of the general public and not the politician as their appropriate leadership. So forget about the equations, forget about the statistical details. If you have a real problem, a felt problem, then you should be able to explain it in ordinary language to the ordinary reader. If you engage in this, it may not be immediate, but over a space of 2 or 3 or 4 years, you will generate an educated populace. This educated populace will then naturally put pressure on their politicians, and they will immediately start demanding more. Whether or not that will be finally successful, I don't know, but to me, this is the proper way to go. So I have used up my 10 minutes. Thank you.
I next bring in Dr. Sultan Hafeez Rehman, followed by Dr. Zahid Hussain. Now, before I let both of you get into this, I want to address a collective question to both of you. Since Dr. Hafeez has not only been our colleague at BIDS for many years, and we had many adventures together, but he then spent most of his later professional career in the Asian Development Bank. And Zahid, who is known to all of us as a high-quality economist concerned with Bangladesh, has, of course, had perhaps even longer innings at the World Bank, but mostly in Dhaka. Now, the question I put to you is that a great deal of research on development and specifically on Bangladesh has originated in works initiated by you and
commissioned by your respective organizations. The question I want to ask is that how far were your research agendas influenced by the dominant policy philosophies of your respective organizations, and how far was the design of the research and the expected outcomes required to validate the dominant underlying philosophical premise of the policy making in these organizations? And the related question to this is that you will both have been familiar with what Salim Rashid has mentioned as the great success stories of our generation, the experience of the Asian tigers, and that both the World Bank and the ADB, if my memory is correct, brought out major studies explaining the success stories of the Asian tigers, which was essentially configured to validate some of the dominant policy assumptions of these two organizations. But sadly, more or less as the print on the reports was drying, they ran into the famous Asian financial crisis. And no one quite explained then the trajectory of causality between the original studies, the hypothesis, and the end result, and how far this has led to any reinterpretation of the Asian success stories. And how far again has there been any successful research initiated to conceptualize and learn from the two greatest global developmental success stories today, China and Vietnam? And how far has any attempt been made to encourage research in Bangladesh and other countries to draw appropriate lessons from this, or do they, or is it not regarded in these organizations that the experience of these two countries deserves to be in fact studied and certainly not to be followed? So Hafeez, let me provoke you with these propositions to get down in 10 plus minutes.
Thank you, sir. I think the question that you have posed, that would require perhaps a broader discussion. Let me try to address it, at least some of it, within the framework of what I sort of had in mind about what I might share as a panelist today. I hope my voice is carrying. I think it's useful to think of this whole question of divide between research and policy, or the challenge of connecting research to policy, can be thought of in terms of a demand side and a supply side, and I think this has already been alluded to. So on the demand side, there is the we have a policy making system which really works on a firefighting mode. They need everything yesterday. They don't necessarily think strategically. It's not so important for them to think strategically. And the difficulty, of course, this poses a challenge to those who are doing policy research, and even greater difficulties for those who are engaged in academic research, who are not really interested in short-term issues. So we also have this mindset issue within the policymakers, which is quite deeply entrenched, and that is that policy research or research is not something that, you know, is practical enough for us to use on a day-to-day basis, and therefore they are not as keen as they might have been to use the outputs that policy researchers produce. I have to say that they are also very reluctant to share data, and without data, researchers cannot really do policy-relevant research. The government is sitting on large amounts of data. They should be able to release this data on a routine basis to those who do research, but that doesn't happen. These are structural constraints on the demand side. And we have a growing private sector now, a very strong private sector, and there are some NGOs, with these non-state actors, who are also actually in a position to sponsor research. But once again, there is this, definitely the private sector, which has very specialized needs, has not even begun to sponsor research on a scale that would be required in order for the research community to be able to influence and support them. So I think it's important to think of both supporting the policy-making process, but also those who deeply influence the policy-making process. These are non-state actors, not state actors. on the supply side, we have, I think, a problem which has existed for some time. Bangladesh is growing, its numbers are also growing. But by that standard, we don't see still an adequate supply of quality researchers. Here, by quality researchers, I don't mean people who do highly esoteric research, those who publish in, you know, the leading journals of the world. That's not what I mean by quality researchers. I mean something very similar to what Professor Salim Rashid was referring to. The ability to pose research questions, questions that are relevant, the ability to then conduct simple analysis, but credible analysis, which based on data, which will bring you down to, will throw up some conclusions which would be relevant for the policymakers to be able to tell this complete story. That's all the quality I think one needs, and this ties in with one of the issues that Professor Rehman Sobhan raised for us to consider. This is what my direct experience in East Asia and Indonesia and Thailand and, you know, to a large extent in Korea, but a very brief stint in Korea and Vietnam tells me that you don't really need the frontier, cutting-edge kind of research that economists are so proud of. But you need that connection for sure. And each one of these countries have had a long history of connecting with highly trained policy researchers who have worked closely with the government across ministries and government departments, and helped to formulate the policies. And this has happened for years on end, and very importantly, this has been led by officials at the very top of the government, sometimes by the political leader of the country themselves, who have chaired weekly meetings of an economic council or another, in one form or another. And this is something of a lesson that I take away, and I take very seriously. These people were all technocrats, and it seemed that the technocrats and the bureaucrats, they were able to form this relationship, which was very productive in their cases. In Bangladesh, what are we trying to do? We, despite the excellent start that was made by the first planning commission of the country, one of the main actors of which is revered to all of us and is chairing this session, and I am sure he will bear me out, that, you know, they use the economists of the Bangladesh Institute of Development Economics and then of Development Studies for the period that they were there, and then were able to get maximum mileage from them in an extremely difficult situation. Sir himself described a particular example in this case. But what was happening? We saw a process, the birth of a process by which we had top technocrats at the head of the policy-making planning process, which was actually who had a research and academic background, and who then were bringing in academics from outside and researchers from outside to help tackle some of the burning questions of the day. So despite that good start, and I think the Planning Commission, I have to say that they have maintained this tradition in one way or another, perhaps not as strongly as one would have liked, but it is still there at every planning cycle, 5-year planning cycle. We see this, and we see this in their other strategy documents as well. So there is a good connection there. And BIDS has played an important role there. But this hasn't still spilled over into the broader research community in a way, in the country, in a way that they would also be drawn into this process, and their capacity for conducting policy analysis and policy research would also rise with the kind of demand that actually potentially exists within the government. We do on the, I think, we've tried to continue to open space by dialogue with the government. This is something that we have to continue doing from the supply side. I think one of the things to try and avoid, and I think most try to avoid this, I'm talking now about the policy research types in Bangladesh, the think tanks, some NGOs who do research and so on, not so much the universities, who are meant to do more academic research. They do try, and I think this effort has to continue to open up space. The policymakers, because of the constraints that I, one of the constraints that I mentioned, are not always in a position to think through issues. So there also, they need the support and assistance of the policy researchers. I would say that I agree with most of what Professor Salim Rashid said about especially the structural problem that he cited about the donor community, but I wouldn't say that all of the research that took place has flown over, you know, the sort of policy relevant space of Bangladesh. Some of it has definitely been useful. Yeah. But you want me to? Okay. So I would suggest that in terms of trying to close this divide, that our traditional sort of approach, which is doing seminars, workshops, conferences, and so on, it's still useful, still needs to be done. But we now have technology, we now have social media, which is extremely active, and I think we need to be able to use that media much more than we normally do. Thank you.
Zahid? And while you're moving there, let me translate what I had made as remarks into some specific questions for you to respond to. One is, if I'm not mistaken, your current resident res rep is from China.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But how come we have never seen any Chinese consultants brought into Bangladesh to in fact give us some guidance on the Chinese experience or mission sent out to China to learn from there? And the second question is, what would be the possibility of the resident mission underwriting some lecture tours by Professors Stieglitz and Piketty to come and discuss some of the problems which they address in their research related to both globalization and poverty?
Thank you, sir. Unlike Professor Salim Rashid, I have to admit that I got reasonable amount of time to prepare this presentation, thanks to Dr. Murshid, who notified me well in advance. So since I spent some time to prepare the material, and Sultan Hafeez has, I don't know what you think, has very cleverly answered the questions that there are some of the leading questions that Professor Rehman Sobhan has asked. So I would first quickly go through the thoughts that I have, and then try to answer the difficult questions which Professor Rahman Sobhan has asked. Now, I'm not as pessimistic about economics as many others, although we know it's a dismal science. Because economics today, I think, is much more rich in terms of tools developed to help the policymakers than it used to be 25 years ago. We now have different branches of economics, behavioral economics, contract theory, the new institutional economics. Professor Rashid has been critical of the experimental economics, but they do have a role in improving our understanding of what's going on in this world. And for development policymakers, we have some very standard tools like evaluative research, and which start with a policy question and try to understand what kind of policy response is effective under what circumstances. And then we have various methodological research which provide toolkits to policymakers to do their business, starting from IMF's financial programming to World Bank's macro fiscal model and to various computable general equilibrium models of many other institutions. So the toolkit today is, I think, much richer than it used to be. And yet there is a research policy divide. So how do we explain that? I think the key question is not that there is a total divide. The key question is, why does some answers, some ideas that are in the research arena get accepted and acted upon, while many other ideas are simply ignored and they disappear? I think to answer that question, I mean, there is no simple answer to that question, but I think perceptions, context, research, the institutional link between research and policy, and evidence are important part of the explanation. Now, on perceptions, I think we, the researchers, have some stereotypes about policymakers, and policymakers have some stereotypes about researchers. We think that the researchers think that policymakers are too busy to pay attention, they're never interested. They have limited perspective, they reach hasty conclusions, and they do not trust survey and research findings. Policymakers also have their perceptions. They think that the researchers avoid policy implications of their research. They use technical jargons excessively. And they are most often inconclusive, and there is a lot of disagreement within the profession. In fact, there is a joke that there are two laws in economics. The first law is that for every economist, there is an equal and opposite economist. And the second law is that they are both wrong. So now, how these perception gap, how these play out in reality, depends on the context, depends on the links and evidence. Now, on the context, I think the mental models that policymakers have is very important. Now, if you think that climate change is a Chinese hoax, if that is your mental model, then no amount of research will help you address that climate change issue. Now, it also depends on the demand that the policymakers have for research, and the capacity gaps that exist in the country in question. And I think most important, the criticality of policy in political competition. Now, what shapes the criticality of policy in political competition? I think two things are important. One is the plurality of players in the research arena. Now, today we have, in all countries, not just public think tanks, but also a variety of private think tanks which exist. And there is a general presumption that the more the players, the better are the chances that research will be heard. That remains to be seen, that remains to be established. And the second thing is what Dr. Salim Rashid in the beginning mentioned, and Professor Rahman Subhan has been alluding to, is the role of the external players, the external influence. And I think it will be a distortion of reality to say that there is both positive and not so positive impact of the role of the external players. But I agree with Sultan Hafeez Rahman that we cannot say that in all cases the research that has come out of the of institutions like the World Bank or the ADB or the International Monetary Fund have not helped us understand how economies progress and all the different sort of development issues. Now on the links, I think what I mean is the feedback mechanisms, the consultation processes that exist. Now in Bangladesh, we know for fiscal policy, we have all these pre-budget consultations and post-budget consultations. For monetary policy, we have, before the monetary policy statement is prepared, there are some consultations. But what we have not really studied very hard is how these consultations actually end up influencing fiscal policy decisions or the monetary policy decisions. Now we know that pressure groups matter. Like you saw the case of the new VAT law that got dropped, but that was not because there was research advice against the new VAT law. That was interest groups prevailing on that issue. Now on evidence, I think there are two divides in evidence. One is the method divide. There is this, I think the Western economics is now blinded by science. There is a huge gap between what's happening in academic economic research and what the policymakers actually need. The emphasis on quantitative methods. I mean, I was hearing a commentator in the previous session that you were talking about theoretical model, but we didn't see any equations in the paper. Now, I disagree with this, that only equations are the only way of representing a model. You can have a model without having a single equation. That's possible. Western American universities have gone to the extreme on this. We are fortunate that, in some sense, that the analytical rigor in our research is very different from what we see in Western research. But there is a methodological divide on this. How much emphasis should be put on what is called evidence-based policy, where evidence only means quantitative evidence. But we also have to keep in mind that evidence-based policy, you could have bad evidence-based policy. If evidence is flawed, if evidence is incomplete, then that evidence-based policy is not going to be very helpful. Now, in settling which evidence is useful and which evidence is not, I think in Bangladesh in particular, there is a problem of data divide. Now, I give you one example. If you look at national accounts data, you will see per capita income in real terms rising year after year, smoothly rising. You look at household income and expenditure survey data, income per capita between surveys is lackluster. It increased between 2005 to 10, but in real terms between 2010 to 2016, it has been either stagnant or in some areas falling. Now, how do you reconcile these two sets of data? If data is not credible, how do you produce credible evidence? So, in conclusion, I would say I'm not that pessimistic about the link between research and policy. The opening do come up when, say, a election is coming and political parties are preparing manifesto, they seek assistance from policy researchers. When there is a disaster, such as the Rohingya issue, then they do listen to policy researchers. A new technology, such as SOFIA, comes in, people get interested in what is known in that area. So there are opportunities that sometimes come up, and researchers have to seize that opportunity. But now, before I end, let me try to answer the tough questions Professor Rahman Sobhan has asked. One is the Chinese country director. We had an urban conference, the late Mayor Anisul Haq was present, and we did have a video conference with two Chinese mayors from China. So that's the only contribution that we have so far made. We did bring Professor Stiglitz, I think 10, 15 years ago. He was here as chief economist of the World Bank. But this is a question that is beyond my pay grade. If my management wants to bring them, I'm sure the Dhaka office will be very glad to host them. On your bigger questions, I would be more direct than Sultan Hafeez. How far research agendas are influenced by the dominant philosophy in the World Bank? 100%. What else would you expect? An institution will not act contrary to the philosophy that it believes in. So I would say, as far as the research questions are concerned, of course the dominant philosophy determines what questions we ask. But in my personal experience as working on Bangladesh economy, and I have only worked on Bangladesh economy 95% of my time in the World Bank, the answers are not predetermined. We are perfectly free to, based on evidence of course, to come up with the answer that the evidence is telling us. Secondly, experience of East Asian tigers. Now, East Asia has two different models. One is the political model, and the other is the economic model. World Bank does not have any views on the political model of East Asia. That's something politicians will decide. But on the economic model, I think, at least I personally feel, that the East Asian experience is much more relevant than the Western experience of development. So surely not everything that East Asians did can be replicated in countries like Bangladesh. We have our own social dynamics. But there are lessons to learn, and that's what I think we try to do. And I hope I have answered your questions, at least partially. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Zahid. You made a very good effort, and I appreciate that. Let me invite Mr. Abul Kasem Khan, President of the Dhaka Chamber, and let me also address a question to you. That how far does the private sector wish to or tends to draw upon research evidence in order to guide your own policy advice which you give to the government? And how far do you attempt to sponsor research which will in fact give you usable evidence which will be helpful in making your business and investment decisions?
Thank you, sir. First of all, I'd like to thank BIDS for inviting Dhaka Chamber. I think I'm the odd one out. All the economists, I'm privileged and honored to be here today. We all know the...
You are a valuable customer of research, so you can...
I am a valuable customer, sir. Thank you. We all know the importance of private sector and also in the context of Bangladesh. And private sector is very much part and parcel of the growth of Bangladesh, from generating employment to paying taxes, helping the GDP to grow further. We all know the vision set by the Honorable Prime Minister and her government, Vision 2021 and Vision 2041. From Dhaka Chamber in 2010, we gave a vision called Bangladesh Strategy 2030, where we believe that Bangladesh will become the 30th largest economy by the year 2030. And recently, PwC, PricewaterhouseCoopers, also predicted Bangladesh to be the 28th largest country by 2030. So Dhaka Chamber was quite right in assuming that. And by 2050, PwC report further says that Bangladesh will become the 23rd largest country, GDP larger than Malaysia and Thailand.
The East Asian economy was brought up in discussion, why East Asian tigers became the East Asian tigers, that needs to be researched. One of the findings that from Dhaka Chamber, we came out with some fact finding. We have seen that if you take South Korea as a country, as a case study, and then take Vietnam, South Korea from 1960 to 1990 invested about 9.5% of the GDP into infrastructure, that is roads, port, hardcore infrastructure. And if you take the example for Vietnam over the last 10 years have been investing about 12% of the GDP. And that is our finding. And where is Bangladesh? Recently, our investment last budget figures says that we have earmarked 2.8% of GDP for infrastructure. So that is, we are at the bottom tier. So when we are comparing Bangladesh with East Asia, Vietnam, and South Korea, even China, this is the lacking we find, that not proper research is being done. Why these countries have excelled or developed faster and have become modern countries. So research should be market driven, and research should be engaged with the private sector. And why we think that that should be, because today what is happening in Bangladesh, I must say that we are policy fighting continuously. We are fighting with the policy planners about what is wrong in the policy. Why this is happening? Because the policy planners are not engaging the real stakeholders of the economy, which is the private sector. And meetings after meetings we are having with the NBR, with the Commerce Ministry, with various ministries. And the time and the effort it's taking for us, it's painstaking, because end of the day, the results are not as per our required requirements. So here, I think there is a huge gap. So we, from the private sector, at least from Dhaka Chamber, we have been pushing or suggesting that in the policy design itself, private sector needs to be engaged. We need to design our policies. If we are going to be the users of the policies, the beneficiary of the policies, why not take us into consideration so that we don't waste time in policy fighting. Rather, we will be part of the policy and we cannot criticize our own policies. So I think the time has come to engage the private sector more in the policy design, in fact, also in the policy monitoring. So this is where I think Bangladesh needs to play a pioneering role in the context of policy design. Vietnam is doing it. I think China is doing it. Many countries are doing it. It's nothing new. In 2010, we proposed the creation of R&D Bangladesh from Dhaka Chamber. And that R&D Bangladesh was later converted into BILD, the public-private dialogue system where reforms is taking place. It's an initiative by Dhaka Chamber, Metropolitan Chamber, Chittagong Chamber, and the SME Foundation. And it is a very successful model that is creating a good resource for the government, for the private sector, in terms of fighting the policies. So there is some improvement, or I would say some progress made. BILD is one of the initiatives. We have proposed from Dhaka Chamber for the creation of national infrastructure development monitoring authority under the Prime Minister's Honorable Prime Minister's chairmanship, where we want to be engaged from the private sector to monitor these large infrastructure projects. So this is one of the proposals we have already proposed to the Honorable Prime Minister's office. It is pending approval. We need to find out the status. So in terms of the last part I would cover is the R&D Bangladesh. So what we are trying to do, sir, this year from Dhaka Chamber is to create a platform where we want to bring in researchers, We want to engage the business community, and we want to first initiate a discussion. What is research doing? What is research? Where the research is happening? On what subject the research is happening? And if we can have a bridging point where we would be interested to finance particular universities, particular projects, where the researchers are market-driven, where the researchers are benefited, because end of the day, researchers need to be also benefited from their research work. So the engagement process, we want to start this year. In fact, we have already formed a platform. We have proposed to the government also how they can be engaged. So Dhaka Chamber would create this platform where we want the business and the university researchers to come. So here the private sector would be engaged and would be interested to look into this. Regarding the VAT law, Dr. Zahid Hussain brought up the VAT law. Why did the VAT law fail? VAT law failed because the impact analysis was not done. If the NBR would have done their homework, probably the VAT law would have been implemented, because we argued that there is no impact, the prices will go up. And we did it not on research, but we did it on assumptions. So the impact of the research is very important in any policy design. So I would end here, and I would also like to thank BIDS for inviting me. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I would hope that you would invite some of the leading research institute heads to come and sit with the Dhaka Chamber to then have a dialogue on what are your research needs and how far they can be responsive to this.
Yes, sir. We would do that.
Well, I'm very happy to invite Dr. Bhagya, Banik, Executive Chairman of BARC. And why I'm particularly happy to have you here is that for a long time we have always believed that the one research entity which was taken very seriously by governments, and particularly by the Agricultural Ministry and its very competent minister today, who has been there almost 15 years in two tenures, that she takes research very seriously. So what has been your experience in getting research accepted by government, and how far have they communicated their research needs to you?
Thank you, sir. Today I am very happy to hear in this very lovely session. First, I will say that I am not an economist or a policy maker man, but I am agriculture researcher also. And sir already questioned me for I would like to answer after my some comments then. Dear participants, for strengthening of agriculture research management and coordination of the national agriculture research system, the Bangladesh Agriculture Research Council, there is act formulated in 2012. Research priorities in Bangladesh agriculture and vision document 2030 has been prepared for undertaking research and development projects, and all the NARS national agriculture research institutes generate the demand lead agricultural technologies like varieties and management practices and information. It also covers scaling up the developed technologies, including our trial. Priority has already given to address the problem areas for our agriculture, that is like hills, coastal haur, and barren tracts. That are more prone to weather, and that have proportionately higher population of poor and vulnerable people. Actually, our government already take some initiatives, for that integrated implementation of a number of including targeted utilization of agricultural incentives. like in order to increase our agriculture production, in addition to regular subsidy, 20% cash incentives are provided on agricultural exports, and a 20% rebate is being provided on bills of electricity consumed by irrigation pumps. The rate of incentive for mechanization also has been set. It is about 70% at our areas and coastal parts of southern Bangladesh. And we have our agriculture ministry, we have a 7-5-year plan also, and at that there is a vision for agriculture at this 7-5-year our program. The major focus of the 7-5-year in the sector therefore centers on consolidating and expanding the productivity gains already achieved in food grain production, you know. Use of environment friendly green technologies like integrated pest management, integrated nutrient management, and alternate wet and drying system in our agricultural research. And in also, dear colleagues, research extension farmers linkage we have developed, and currently the extension service draws its strength from research findings as well as from farmers' opinion also. On the other hand, it acquires up-to-date findings from research and transfers them to the farmers. And on the other hand, it brings feedback from our fields and farmers. And I know that you question our agriculture minister, our honorable, is very proud, we feel very proud because we are self-sufficient in our food, in nutrition and quality, but we feed 160 million people with her excellencies, her that are under all directions. And so now we have a SDG goal target also, and we have already targeted all the projections. And in agriculture, and the goal to end hungry and sustainable our agriculture, already we have planned. And in some cases, we have quantified to some extent, not fully, product to develop our productivity double in 2030. So I think that our respected sir already said everything that our agriculture minister and his direction is so nice. We are very happy in this moment. And our policy also very good under her supervision. And now I think we need harmonization of policies and strategies and linkage between researchers and policymakers. We like not BIDS, but we always try with our best to sit every stakeholders, and our private partnership also we are engaged in our agriculture research. So I need the important policies, and that is like national agricultural policy, national agricultural extension policy, national seed policy, and 7-5-year plan. And the 7-5-year plan also in business a wide range of steps on this issue. So I am finally, I would like to thank Honorable Session Chair to give me the chance to say some words in this August gathering. Thank you once again.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this positive. So, Murshid, is everyone's stamina now reached its final point, and do we start winding up?
I think so, sir.
All right, then good. So let me conclude by thanking the panel for making their sort of respective contributions. I can't say that all my questions were fully answered, but I must say that some bold attempts were made to do so, and I appreciate that. I think the nature of the question addressed, I think, some of the basic issues of the nexus between research and policy. I think whilst the chair of BARC is a good living example of research being motivated by a highly engaged minister who consciously attempts to use research as a guidance for doing her job. How far this is a normal practice is a moot question. I had long experience from both sides, and the one which has always stayed in my mind is the brief period when I was in the Presidential Advisory Council of President Shahabuddin, when instead of generally whiling away my time as the advisor for planning, I commissioned 29 task force studies. Some of you may have participated in them, to in fact bring in, what is it, over 250 of the top researchers and professionals in the country to in fact come up with a series of policy recommendations for the incoming elected government of the day. And the idea was that those were the days in which the donor agencies patronized expatriate consultants, and domestic professional capabilities were heavily underrepresented. And I was of the view that you have these huge talents. What can we do to connect them with the policy-making process? And these 250 of the best people at market prices probably carried out $20 million worth of research over there. But all that was invested, and that was self-invested, was the price of tea and biscuits for the meeting of these researchers. And it was a demonstration of, if you motivate people, they are willing to, in fact, perform their tasks as an act of public service, provided that they are willing, that people are willing to reach out to them. The tragedy of that experience was that the 29 task force reports were presented to the then newly elected government. And on the occasion that I had to perhaps visit them, now in those days, and since I don't visit with ministers, I could see the dust visibly gathered on the covers of these reports. And so when we tried to bring in a similar group of people, when CPD was then carrying out its policy reviews in 2001, these same people looked at me and said, you got us to do all this work 5 years ago, and no one took any notice of us. Aren't you, in fact, really overdoing it when you ask us to come back and do the same thing on this particular occasion? But they did come, and they did again produce updated reviews on what could be done. And again, in fact, there was really no response from the policymakers for all this committed research which came in. The whole founding of CPD as an organization was to in fact connect BIDS and the research community with the policymakers and the political community and the business community so that they would come round the table and be exposed to quality research and to then collectively try and find policy solutions to the many, many problems facing the country. So there is a huge problem of market failure over here. And this is presumably also had a demotivating effect on the supply side. But my concluding advice to you is, and I have made this before, that at the end of the day we are excessively obsessed with projecting our research only to the policy-making establishment. And it's right that we do so because actually they do get to make policies and we should go on hammering at them and trying to get a response from them. But if they are not responding and there is a retreat from what Omurto Sen called public reasoning, where they are unwilling to sit down and engage seriously in addressing problems, particularly where they may be, where the limitations of what are being done may be brought to their notice, when they should learn from this and say, well, thank you very much. I have found some benefit from this and can I now get on and make better use of what we are really doing with our policies. Now, if that culture does not exist, then the researcher does have a very genuine problem. But the last point I therefore wish to make from this is that at the end, we are all empowered, hopefully, citizens of Bangladesh. And we have a higher calling in relation to those who we should deem as our masters. And these are the people of Bangladesh. And we as professionals owe them a blood debt to actually address the problems that they face and to come up with serviceable ideas to resolve these problems. And as researchers, to then go one step further and to then find ways and means of delivering this message to them and prior to doing your research, to interacting with them so that you can understand their felt needs and you can incorporate these into our research agendas. So the way in which research is committed, commissioned and motivated and carried out in a way has serious disadvantages because we are not really reaching out to the real genuine customers who need this sort of work and this sort of ideas. And the idea should be to connect with these constituencies, to motivate them to the infinite possibilities which are available to them and within them to in fact transform this country and through research to get them to raise their voice and to become a large constituency where voice is registered to take your ideas and in fact bring them to some serviceable use both for them directly and for the policy makers. Because keep in mind that at the end of the day, whilst policy making is important, while public action is important, a great deal of what is going on in this country does not originate from those sources. It is originating from within the people who are doing the things. It is the farmers who are quadrupling agricultural production. It is the garment workers who are interacting with the dynamic entrepreneurial class to produce $30 billion of exports. It is the humblest and most oppressed of our people who are going abroad at great cost and great risk to in fact generate our enormous sort of finance foreign exchange reserves. And these are genuine customers who need all the services that research can provide. So there is a fundamental challenge to all of us, how to connect with these constituencies, how to serve them, how to deliver research to them. So the divide, in a way, is a synthetic divide, reflecting a very static and sterile perspective of the concept of what is policy and for whom is policy actually intended. And I think in this day and age now, particularly where the technological means of communication have become so advanced, I would look to the entire research community to respond to these challenges. So good luck to all of you, and thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Professor Rehman Sobhan, for conducting an excellent session on research and policy divide. On behalf of BIDS, I would like to thank the panelists of this session, Dr. Sultan Hafeez Rahman, Dr. Zahid Hussain, Mr. Abul Kasem Khan, and Dr. Bhagya Rani Banik for giving excellent support towards research and to BIDS. I would like to thank Hafeez Bhai particularly for shortening his trip in London to attend this meeting. Let me thank also all participants, particularly the panelists and chair of each session, for trusting us, for being trustworthy, and for your excellent cooperation that made this conference a success. And finally, I would like to thank all my colleagues at BIDS who were instrumental for organizing this conference in all the divisions of BIDS and under the supervision of our Director General, Dr. K.S. Murshid. So thank you all for supporting us during these 2 days.
Okay.